Amen, amen. Okay. What? Are y'all awake? I'm gonna need y'all. When I say good morning, I need you to say good morning. Good morning. Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Okay, so we're gonna do something a little different, right? Just because I'm a little different. And so here's what I've decided. Is there any of my women's basketball team here? Any women basketball? I see you. I see you, right? We do travel just a little different sometimes. Anybody ever been to a baseball game here, SNU baseball game? If you haven't, you need to. Because when they come up to bat, their song is played that kind of represent them and bring them out. Well, here's what I've decided. When we're talking about the word of Jesus, the word of God, and we're talking about Jesus, we need to be just as hype. And so I've decided we're going to start chapel a little different. Again, because I'm a little different. And so I've picked out my own theme song. But I need your participation, right? Because with any theme song, there has to be some hype in it, right? So I know I got some front row support. So I know y'all are going to hype it, right? But here's what we're going to do. Because every time you hear the word of God, it should pump you up. And you should come with an expectation that you're going to hear something fresh and new because the word of God is alive. It's not dead. And so in order to kind of prepare for the word of God, I've asked them to play what I would say is probably my theme song and kind of gives a little bit of what we're going to talk about today. So I'm going to kind of walk out. Walk back in, but I need you to stand on your feet because we need to get hype and bring in the Holy Spirit. Just usher it in, and we need the word of God to come correct. So stand up on your feet. Stand up on your feet.
Sing like never before. Oh, my soul.
Wait, hold up. Yeah, I got a God, don't change with the season. Yeah, 10,000 reasons I can believe in. God's so good, say less I'm breathing.
What? That's the only hype I got? Come on. Oh, we're going to have to work on this. Come on. All right. You know what? I'm going to have to teach some of y'all. Y'all going to have to stop by the center. I'm going to have to teach y'all a few moves. And we're going to have to do this correct every time. Right, Hope? Right. Every time. Because I need you to come to chapel with expectation. Every time. I need you to be on fire for God because he's on fire, ready to move and use you. So I do have a word today that I'm going to share with you, but I'm going to start off with that word. I need you to stand again for the word of God out of respect, right? And so if you put that scripture up, we're actually coming out of Matthew, and it talks about Jesus calming the storm. We're going to start chapter 8, verse 23, right? It says, when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. And behold, a violent storm developed on the sea so that the boat was being covered by the waves. But Jesus himself was asleep. And they came to him and woke him saying, save us, Lord, we're perishing. And he said to them, why are you afraid, you men of little faith? Then he got up, rebuked the winds and the sea, and it became perfectly calm. The men were amazed and said, what kind of man is this that even the winds obey him? Father God, I just thank you right now for the opportunity to bring your word fresh, alive, and new. Lord, do what you do best. Show up and show out and move in each and every person under the sound of my voice and those that are listening. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. All right, have a seat. So here's what I want to talk about. Who's in your boat? Because when this storm came, one of the first things they did was they panicked. But if I can give you a little context, before they even got into the boat, because the disciples was there with Jesus, before they got into the boat, Jesus had already performed 10 other miracles. And in his ministry, there was about 37 miracles that he performed, but the disciples actually was witness to that. And so in my imagination, I would think that God was thinking, okay, you've seen me perform these miracles. Why do you not have faith that I would not allow us to perish? But here's what I want to say. As humans, as people that, you know, Jesus was fully God, fully man. But as people, sometimes we have doubt and we don't have the faith that God has called us to have. And we forget who's in the boat. We forget his power. And we almost put God in this little box. But here's what I'm here to tell you. He already knew that there was going to be some doubt. Fully man, fully God. He already knew. And so he used it as an opportunity to stretch their faiths. And so I don't necessarily want to talk to you today about the disciples. What I want to talk to you about is who's in the boat. When life gives you storms, when things happen, who's in your boat? So if we recap this a little bit, I found a few pictures that I thought was kind of cool. And so if you'll start kind of showing some of those pictures, let's retell this story. God had kind of, you know, I did some research and actually found out that's what the boat looked like. Because if you actually look at some of the illustrations, you'll see like it's a little rowboat. Okay, but it wasn't a rowboat. It looks more like that boat, right? And so God had already done his ministry and work, and he was tired. And so he took a little nap, right? Storms was calm, but in the Sea of Galilee, it's not uncommon for a storm to come out of nowhere. And a storm came, right? And it disrupted things. It began to shake the boat to the point that they believed that they were about to perish. They got fearful of the storm. They got fearful because God was not only silent, he was asleep. But here's what I need to tell you about maybe the storm in your life. God is still there. And even if he's silent, he works in silence. God works in the meanwhile. He's never going to leave you or forsake you. He said it in his word. But sometimes he allows you to go through storms in order to grow your faith. Now, I would tell you, if I had to choose, I would never go through a storm. I wouldn't just naturally pick that I want to go through hard times. I would not naturally pick. I mean, if I got to choose my life, everything would be beautiful, right? And it would all flow. And I would have been a 4.0 student in my undergrad, which I was not. I went to class, but I was not. When I got to my master's program, right, I maybe would have paid attention to some things over others. I mean, like, literally, I would have had the life. I wouldn't have struggled financially. Everything I saw, I probably would have gave to myself. Let's just, I mean, let's just be honest. There's just some things you see that you're like, that would be so cute on me. But you know you can't really buy it because that's not in your budget. But if I was choosing my life, it would be in my budget. And so, okay, that was funny. Y'all didn't even like laugh. Okay, anyway. So I'm telling you, I would not choose the storms. But sometimes we go through those storms because God wants us to realize that he's right there with you. His silence does not mean absence. His silence does not mean that he's forgotten about you. The storm itself does not mean that he's abandoning you. But he knows everything about you. And he knows that even when the storm comes, if you brace yourself, if you become focused, and you focus on him and not the storm, that you will get through it. It may not look the way you want it to look. It may not be the way you want it to be. But if you focus on him and not the storm, you will get through it. Because the point of the story is not the storm. It's who was in the boat every time. Who's in your boat? Because when God is there, things happen. When God is there, miracles happen. When God is there, he shows up and he shows out every time. Maybe not the way you want it, but it's the way that's according to his will. Every time. But who are you trusting? Are you trusting the people in your boat, knowing that they are there with you, knowing that they are encouraging you, knowing that they are going to God for you? If you have people in your boat that want to have a pity party when you have a pity party, you might need to think about who's in your boat. Because at some point, there has to be focus on God and not the storm. Because if you focus on the storm, you will get engulfed in the storm. Because I don't know about you, but some of the storms I went through, me and God had some very honest conversations. Like, could it have been any other way to get my attention? Could have been anybody else but this person? Could we have talked about this in a different way? But let's be honest. Sometimes we do not go to God first. And we don't give him that time. Sometimes he needs to get our attention. Because we are prioritizing other things over our time with God. His silence does not mean he's left you. Sometimes his silence means I'm waiting on you. There are some areas in my life where God literally said, when you get through, I'm ready to take it to a whole nother level. But you spinning and you're doing all this, but I want to give you more than you ever imagined. But it takes trust. It takes faith. And what God knows, we can't always see. In the disciples' defense, they saw a storm. They saw that they were about to perish. They saw that they were going to die. And the man that has performed these miracles brought people back to life, healed lepers, made a blind man see. The man that can do so much was asleep. But here's what the Bible tells you. If you just have the faith of a mustard seed, that's like a dot on an eye. That's how small a mustard seed is. if you would just have that faith and go to him. It's easy to go to our friends. It's easy to go to others. But I'm telling you, he wants to speak to you. Whether it's the first time, whether it's the 100th time, whether you're in the middle of something, he wants to hear from you. He's our heavenly Father. And sometimes our faith is so small that we make him small. We figure we can't see our way through that storm because we've put him in a box. You can't put him in a box. He's not a box God. He's an all-power, all-knowing, everywhere God. He doesn't belong in a box. He doesn't belong on your shelf when you need him because life is going bad. He wants to have a relationship with you every day. He wants to hear about your day. That's the person you have to have in the boat. If you are going to make it through this storm, that's the person you have to have in a boat. There's this story of this farmer. And some of you may have heard me tell this before, but there's this story of this farmer. And this farmer had a donkey. And on his property, there was a well. The well, was not functioning. It was dry, right? But one day, the donkey ended up in the well. The farmer took an assessment, and he realized that the resources that it would take to get the donkey out of the well wasn't worth it. By the way, God would always get you out of a well. But anyway, he realized the resources wasn't worth it. So he petitioned for some dirt. It was a lot of dirt because he decided it's just better to maybe bury the donkey in the well. Then no one else will fall into it. And the donkey is so far, he probably can't make it out anyway, right? So he brought some dirt on his property. And the neighbors, because it was such a massive amount of dirt, his neighbors was like, what are you going to do with the dirt? And they were like, you know what? My donkey has fallen in the well. I'm just going to bury him there. And so not only was the farmer putting dirt on the donkey, but also his neighbors started putting dirt on the donkey. And they just figured as they shovel the dirt, the donkey would get the idea that no one's coming for you. The storm that you're in is a storm that you're going to die in. But let me tell you, never count out a donkey. Because every time they shoveled dirt into that well, guess what the donkey did? He shook it off. Every time. They would dig some more, and he shook it off. And then after a while, they realized, okay, like, why do I still kind of hear the donkey making sound? Like, we didn't shovel a lot of dirt. That's because every time they shoveled dirt, not only did he shake it off, he stepped on top of it. Every time. And after a while, there was so much dirt in the well that it was like a stair step for him to step right out of the well. And when he emerged out of the well, everyone was like, what? How is he still alive? Like, that was his storm. How is he still there? Here's what I hear to tell you. I would happen to believe that the donkey knew Christ. And he didn't give up hope. And he knew that as the storm came, he wasn't going to get over it. He had to get out of it. And so he visualized that. Sometimes you need to begin with the end in mind. You need to realize all that dirt that someone is pouring on you need to shake right off, step on top of it, and get out of the well every time. every time. But it takes a relationship with God to build your faith. And here's the deal. No one's saying you got to start with an hour of you like, okay, God, here I am for a whole hour. No one's saying that. Give me 5 minutes. Because I know when you start to spend time with God, that 5 minutes is going to become 10. That 10 is going to become 20. That 20 has become 30. And before long, you're not even watching the clock. Matter of fact, you look up and you're like, oh my gosh, I got to go. Because fellowship with him is just that sweet. That as you spend time, it stops being awkward. And you move to a point that you're in a sweet relationship with a heavenly Father that loves you and allowed them to pour dirt on top of you when you were in that well. Nothing happened that God doesn't know. But he also knows what he put inside of you. And he put the stuff inside of you for you to shake that dirt off and you to step on top of it. But you got to trust him. You got to have faith. It's up to you. It's up to you. Because here's what I know. Here's what I know. Most of our problems are not circumstantial. Your happiness, things that you do, it shouldn't be based on your circumstances. If you really look at your problems, your biggest problems can be traced back to an inadequate understanding of who God is. Every time. But you have to trust him. So let's get back to the boat, because I'm starting to wrap up. Let's get back to the boat for a minute. Maybe it's time for you to start expecting who's in your boat. Because if Christ is in your boat, you're going to be heading in the right direction. But sometimes the people you allow in your boat may be drilling holes in your boat when you're not looking. Not because they're trying to sabotage, but sometimes people drill holes in our boat because they can't be the captain. The only captain I want steering my boat is Christ. I love every one of you. I love those that are close to me. I love my family, but they can't steer my boat. They can't, because they're not God. So I need you to look at who's in your boat. Because here's what I would tell you. There's a quote that I found and talks about a sinking ship. The entire sea of water can't sink a ship unless the water gets inside of the ship. Similarly, the negativity of the world can't put you down unless you allow it to get inside of you. Figuratively, you're the boat. Sometimes you allow those negative thoughts to overtake you. Sometimes there's a leak in your boat because you allowed someone to speak into your life that never had the power or the right or the authority to speak into your life. You need to decide who has that right. I decided a long time ago that the only person that had that right to steer my boat or to sink my boat was Christ. Because if he sinks my boat, he was going to find a way for me to make it to shore. And if I didn't make it to shore, then I was going to see him. Point blank, period. And either way, he gonna have my theme song ready. And he gonna be ready to like hype it up, even though y'all was not ready. We're gonna work on that. But he's gonna be ready. Will you? Will you be ready? Are you allowing people to speak into your life and the negativity to overtake you enough that it steers you in a different direction? I am here to tell you today, take command of your boat. I'm here to tell you today, he needs to be in your boat. Because life would be sweeter when those waves come. Because here's the beauty of all of that. When he did awake, if you remember the scripture, he got up and it was like every day. He like told the sea like, peace, be still. He calmed it just like that. He didn't have to write a memo. He didn't have to send an email. He didn't even have to send a text. He spoke and it was. He's ready to speak in your life. He's ready to calm your sea or take you through it. But will you trust him? And don't let the people in your boat tell you not to. And if there is anybody in your boat telling you not to invite him into your boat, I need you to really pray about if they're supposed to be in your boat. Because scripture tells me sometimes that people are in our lives for a reason, a season, or a lifetime. There are too many times when we let people in that lifetime role that was only there for a season. There are many times that we let people in our boat that was only supposed to be there for a reason, and we gave them an entire season. If you don't know, ask him. If you don't know, spend time with him. Because show me your friends, and I'll see your future. Who's in your boat? Father God, I just thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. If there's anyone in this place, Lord, that do not know you, continue to stir in their heart. But Lord, I just ask that you allow them to take inventory of who's in their boat. And Lord, I invite you in to show up in their lives in a way that they have never seen before. Because you can show up and you can show out. So Father God, I thank you so much for the opportunity to share and being used by you. Bless every person under the sound of my voice and those tuning in. Father, I just thank you that you're in my boat. It's in your name I pray. Amen.